givest us free. Give us free.
Your Honor, please instruct the defendant that he cannot disrupt these proceedings with such outcome.
Give us free!
If we are to have any semblance of order in this
Give us free!
Peace, unity, and welcome my conscious and unconscious family and friends. This is the all-new Black Village Community Podcast, and I am truly your host of the show, Jaycee, a.k.a. AfroBlack, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut. Without any fear, as I use my mic as a spear to chucka you with liberated truth. I am your host and your native soldier in the struggle. My purpose and mission for this show is first to enlighten, inform, and engage. And I want to engage with all who claim to know the truth. All truth seekers and my native family, I welcome you. This show is dedicated to all our indigenous native ancestors and to all those who've carried the mantle of truth and to every person with the ability to throw off the chains of comfortable habit and unwarranted assumption and move in a new, liberated direction that is guided by truth and observational evidence, no matter where that direction may lead you. My main objective and purpose here is freedom, mind, soul, and spirit. That being said, welcome to the Black Village Community Podcast and much love from our great universal goddess and mother of all living here and above.
AC in the house.
In a handbag, he done spent his reparations on his swag. A black nigga, put your fortunes in a sandbag. Laugh at your misfortune, then we put it in a hashtag. Ain't no leaders, only leisure, only reapers. Ain't no sowers, they get higher, we get lower. Damn, it's over. If racism ain't a color, then it's damn show in a class. Got the racists on each other. You got niggas, then it's blacks. You got crackers, then it's white. Separated by the green at the 500 years. Think we play for the same team. Smoke screen, make the president a black guy. It ain't no reason why you shouldn't have success, right? 40 acres and a mule. I spent my reparations on the jeweler. I bought a timepiece, now ain't no looking back. Now ask the motherfuckers what the fuck they looking at.
Hey, this is Jaycee, a.k.a. AfroBlack, and I am here with you for another delicious Black Sunday to drop nothing but the raw and uncut here on the Black Village Community Podcast. And you can join me here at the Village Conference Table of Truth with me and my queen to talk on any subject matter that we are speaking on, or maybe if you just have a question. It's all gravy and potatoes. You can join us here. It doesn't cost you a dime. Just a bit of your conscious time. You can chime in at 857-232-0155. You can also chime me in at 855-445-9340. and you need the conference key to get through the conference door, which is 947595. And so today's podcast subject matter, as always, as important as all the ones we do here at the Village, to inform our conscious community, to cause our people to raise questions, to ask questions, to think, to have deep thought, to regurgitate and process information. That's what we do here at the Black Village Community, the Black Village Community Podcast. That's what we do here. And so today's podcast topic is Black Power Politics. Does it exist? Again, Black Power Politics. Does it exist? ? Subtitle, What White People Really Fear. And that's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about what Black Power Politics. I mean, you might, you know, those of you out there listening to this show might be wondering, what is Black Power Politics? Then you got those out there who know what it is, who know what I'm talking about, and they're wondering what perspective I'm going to come from on this one. You know, be the fact that I'm an indigenous black man. I'm an indigenous native black man. You feel me? Due to the fact that I don't consider myself an African conscious black man. I consider myself an indigenous conscious native black man living in America, and that I am at home. I'm not trying to go home. I'm not trying to go across the Pacific. I don't believe my ancestors came from across the Pacific. My ancestors were already here. They were enslaved more than 200 years before the first African was brought here. You feel me? That's the level I'm coming from on this conscious level. And my queen is coming from the same level. So we're going to vibrate on this, and we're going to change the tone so we can have something more laid back to vibrate to. And I'm going to drop it just like this, like I always do. Drop it with a Tribe Called Red, like this. You feel me? And so we're going to kick back. I got some audio casts I want to play. I want to bring back the past, because if I'm going to talk about Black Power Politics, then we got to talk about where it all started. We got to talk about where you when it was really being heard, because you don't really hear Black Power Politics today. You don't hear it today. You feel me? This is the reason why leaders like Malcolm X was cut short. This is the reason why leaders like Martin Luther King, why their voice was cut short. Medgar Evers' voice was cut short. Marcus Garvey's voice was cut short. And many others who may not have had a loud enough microphone, but they were still vocal leaders. You feel me? And so, like the one I want to play in the audio cast, one of my favorite vocal leaders from the 1960s, H. Rap Brown. You feel me? When I was doing a podcast, I think a couple of years ago, or maybe it's been maybe a year, more than a little more than a year ago, on the Black Panther Party, I did a podcast. It took about maybe, I don't know, maybe three separate podcast sessions. You know, I was talking about the formation of the Black Panther Party, and you know, David Okoye, one of the founding members, who most people don't know about. David Okoye, because he's Japanese, but he was right there from the very beginning, before the Black Panther Party was even called the Black Panther Party. He was a part of the formation of it with UEP Newton and the rest of them. So I didn't get a chance to talk about H. Rap Brown back then like I wanted to, but this is going to give me an opportunity when it comes to talking about Black Power Politics. So on that note, let me bring in my queen, who's going to be joining me to this delicious Black Sunday to talk about this subject matter, which I believe is kind of new to her. What you got to say, queen?
Well, first, I'd like to say hello to all my beautiful people. And actually, I'm quite interested in finding out more about what Black Power Politics is. I'm not into politics, so this is going to be something new and fun for me.
You know, that's all good. It's all good. That's because we're all here to share and to learn. That's what it is. That's one of our mottos here at the Black Village Community Podcast. You know, if you care, you will share. And you would do it on a conscious level, because that's what we do. We do it on a conscious level. You feel me? We're not trying to attack people. We're not trying to hurt people. But you know what? Sometimes, especially me, I know I come across that way. I come across like I'm attacking people, or I come across very abrasive, because I'm passionate about the things that I believe. So I have to really pay attention to the way I come across. But my motive is never to hurt and attack people. But that don't take away from the fact that I'm also a warrior and a soldier. So sometime I, as a warrior and a soldier, you're going to jug somebody with the truth. You're going to stab somebody and they're going to get hurt with the truth. You feel me? And so that's what I do with the truth. So we're going to talk about that. Now back to the point of what our podcast topic is about, which is Black Power Politics. Let's first talk about what is Black Power Politics. Now, there's a lot. If you go out there and you research the topic of Black Power Politics, for one thing, Black Power Politics, first you got politics at the end of the sentence. So Black Power, that obviously is a political thing, Black Power being behind it. And if anything, anybody knew anything about the Black Power movement of the 1950s and the 1960s, really the late 50s to the early 60s, and then in the, you know, throughout the 60s, the Black Power movement was about Black liberation. So you know, I saw a lot of people giving definitions of what Black Power Politics is, and I've seen also a lot of commentaries out there giving their version of what Black Power Politics is. So instead of me giving somebody else's definition of Black Power Politics, I thought I'd give my definition of Black Power Politics, due to the fact that I've looked up to a lot of these leaders who were very well spoken, you know, like Kwame Ture. His original name started out when he was the president of SNCC back in the 60s. His name was Stokely Carmichael, but he changed his name to Kwame Ture, and that was fine. He was still a very vibrant, raw and uncut political speaker, but he kind of lost me because he became a Pan-Africanist, and that's not the level I'm on today. And even back then, I had a hard time digesting everything that they believe in. So, but that's another topic and another conversation for another time. So, but these are some of the people that I looked up to as vocal political speakers, and they spoke about Black liberation, they spoke about Black power. And this is, and that's why I say that's another topic for another thing. When you talk about Carmichael, when you talk about Stokely Carmichael, when he became Kwame Ture, Pan-Africanist, it appears his agenda broadened, okay, which is understandable because you have to understand what the Pan-African movement is about, which is about wherever there's Black people at. And I don't agree with the fact that they believe that all Black people are African in one way or another, indirectly or directly. This is their analogy, this is their ideology. I don't agree with that. But when he was Stokely Carmichael, though, the president of SNCC, which started out on the college campus, and he was about the civil right, about Black people having civil rights. He was about students having rights on colleges, and about the curriculum being balanced, more balanced for everybody on the college campuses, instead of being basically more Eurocentric, and which he saw as white supremacy on college campuses. You know, this is about that. He was basically speaking to the powers to be. That's what Black Power Politics is about. Black Power Politics is about, in short, let me write, this is what I wrote. I wanted to kind of put it in a small, let me put it down here. It says, all right, first I'm going to give the definition of Black Power Politics from the definition, which you might find, given a little historical backdrop, okay? The first popular use of the term Black Power Politics as a political and racial slogan was by Stokely Carmichael, later known as Kwame Ture, and Willie Ricks, later known as Mukasa Dada, both organizers and spokespersons for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, during the 1960s in the United States. Young people began speaking and writing this phrase as a form of rebellion. That phrase that he's talking about is Black Power, okay? That's the phrase that they were using back then, okay? So it says, in the 1960s in the United States, young people began speaking and writing this phrase as a form of a rebellion against what they perceived as oppression by the older generation, especially the establishment. Okay, the Black Panther parties used the slogan "All Power to the People" to protest the rich ruling class domination of society. Pro-democracy students used to protest against America's military campaign in Vietnam, which was All Power to the People and Black Power. Now, I want people to know, the whole point of talking about Black Power Politics was also to speak about the fact that when it comes to the term black power, you don't hear that really anymore. You don't hear that being used anymore. You got some people don't think it's necessary to use it because they believe that we have more of an equal multicultural society, as if white supremacy is still not lurking, still not operating, and still not performing as it was back in the 50s and the 60s. And to me, when Obama was president, it showed its face. When you saw the police brutality and killings of young black men and women throughout the U.S. and nothing was really being done about it. And still right now, I still keep it on all my my podcast format pages from that back in 2016, from 2015 to 2016, there were 1,134 deaths of unarmed black men. Now, I'm not speaking to the fact that the number gets larger when you put in unarmed children. When I say children, that's young black, that's children, boys that are under the age of 13, 12 years old, 14, under the age of 15 and 16 being shot by cops. And young girls and women, black women. So that's what brought forth the voice of black power politics. Okay, so now, you know the slogan black power and the slogan power to the people began with Stokely Carmichael, later known as Kwame Ture, and the Black Panther Party also popularized the slogan black power, power to the people. Okay, now my position on the whole thing of what black power means, and this is me encompassing everything that I've read, things that I've documentaries that I've seen, and research that I've done. And this is what I'm going to read right now. This is coming from my perspective. Black power politics, in short, are political ideas with agendas that are meant to aid, educate, and protect black people with equal constitutional rights and liberties under the constitutional law. This was the mindset of forerunners like Frederick Douglass, which was clearly displayed in his 1894 speech, almost 40 years after the Civil War. A speech written by Frederick Douglass titled The Folly of Colonization. A great speech that, in my conscious opinion, should be considered black power politics and should be a part of the U.S. academic school curriculum for all students to read. But it's not. And why not? Because it exposes a serious racist plot and scheme of removing black Americans from America and into a foreign into the foreign country of Africa. But black power politics is clearly exemplified and seen. I got an excerpt from the Frederick Douglass's speech of 1894, which to me exemplifies black power politics in the speech that he wrote in 1894, which is The Folly of Colonization. And from paragraph 3, and it quotes like this: the last sentiment idea makes colonization very fascinating to the dreamers of both colors, but there is really no foundation for it. They tell us that we owe something to our native land. This sounds well, but when in fact it's brought to view, which should never be forgotten, that a man can only save one native land, and that is the land which he is born, the bottom falls entirely out of the sentiment argument. So that right there to me exemplifies, I mean, basically what Frederick Douglass was pointing out, and he was doing this recognizing the political position of those born here in America being native to this country. He said, then you can't say, how you gonna say the black man is that Africa is his native country when America is his native country, because this is where he's born at. Now, when Frederick Douglass wrote this speech, he wrote this in 1894, speaking to a scheme that these people had conjured up, and it took a few years. It goes all the way back to the early 1800s when this idea came up by people who were a part of the abolitionist movement and a part of another organization called the American the American Society. So I can't remember the whole name of this organization, which was
had people who were so-called wanting to move black people out of the U.S. to Africa, as if Africa was their was their home. When Africa is not our that's not our home. People, black Americans who have roots in this country, Africa is not our home. Our home is right here in North America. Our ancestors were right here before Africans were brought here as slaves in 1626. You know, the original indigenous people were enslaved, and those plantations that Africans came to were built by the indigenous slave labor of the people who were already here when Europeans first came here and before they set foot on this land here of Turtle Island, a.k.a. America. So, that's my sum up, black power politics from my perspective. You know, in short, black power politics is a set of ideas with agendas that are meant to aid, educate, and protect black people with equal constitutional rights and liberties under the constitutional law, under the Constitution. So that's what black power politics is. It doesn't create its own standard of laws. It uses the Constitution. It uses our current system of laws to show how injustice is being done and white supremacy is still superseding the law and mistreating people. And that's something that we need to learn to change. So Queen, what do you think so far? Just in short, as far as what you've heard so far, the definition of black power politics.
Well, it sounds good. You know, I think it's something that more people can get involved with the more that they know about it.
Before our show started, I had you pull up. I wanted to read because another example of black power politics. And like I said, black power politics does not create its own law. It uses the system of laws that are in place that's supposed to be just. And black power politics also shows up. Injustice or when something is unjustly done, it shows it up by using truth. Basically, black power politics speaks truth to power, because power is not always truthful. Power is not always just. So black power politics speaks truth to power using its own system of laws to protect, to aid, and to educate black people. So Martin Luther King is another prime example, in my opinion, who spoke, acted out, performed, showed up white supremacy by using black power politic tactics. You know, his method of protesting was called passive resistance. It was called passive resistance. What was it called? I think passive resistance something. Right now I'm having memory short. When it comes to remembering things, but he had a methodology which was called passive resistance something, I can't remember, but that was his way of showing up white supremacy. Whenever he did a march, and it was going to be a big march with kids out there or teenagers out there marching with their parents, he made sure that the press was there. He made sure camera people came. He made sure he called the local press, the national press, made sure that they were out there to record, to view, and to publicize what was going on, because a lot of times these police would come out there and brutalize the people, hurting the people, put them in hospital, and sometimes cases people got killed. And you know what, when the press doesn't show this, people don't know what's going on nationally or internationally. And that, you know, it's one thing America does care about to a degree. They care about how they look internationally. And so that was black power politics working right there. But I got an article right here. And this article is titled 10 Major Accomplishments of Martin Luther King Jr. And so I wanted to jump into the one that I thought expressed more of black power politics. And this one right here, which says he was behind African Americans getting basic civil rights. Martin Luther King organized and led many marches for the voting rights of blacks, desegregating labor rights and other civil rights. His efforts bore fruit when Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Civil Rights Act of 1965.
That's the Voting Rights
Act. The Voting Rights Act of 1965 Act was passed, and most of these rights were enacted into law. Detail, most. Obviously, they didn't take all, but they got in as much as possible. And that was as a result of the perseverance Martin Luther King and others who supported his rallies, his marches, and the things that he was trying to get done for the purpose of giving so that black people have more rights in this country, voting. I mean, that's what the Voting Rights Act was all about. You know, you have black people who wanted to vote and couldn't get vote, because the ballots would get thrown out. I've even read where black people were being shot if they entered the voting booths. They were, before they could even get into the building. Folks out there shooting them, and this is the type of thing you don't hear. The press don't cover that. See, so these are things I'm talking about. Black power politics. You feel me? That get things done for the purpose of black people having rights, being educated, having protection under the law. And so that's what black power politics was supposed to. That was supposed to be the whole agenda of black. The question is, has that agenda gone away? Is it gone? Is it still necessary? You got those who don't even believe it's necessary no more. And that's the reason why you don't have civil rights leaders speaking out no more. And then those who are speaking out have such a small voice. Most of us don't even hear about them. The question is it necessary for us to have Barack Obama, 90% of the black vote, more than almost 100% of the vote went his direction. Regardless of the fact if black people made a difference or not, is the fact that a lot of black folks who didn't vote went out to vote just for him. Did he exemplify black power politics? And the question is, what is wrong with black power politics when it benefits everybody? There's nothing that was done specifically for black people that did not benefit everybody. I want to play an audio cast to speak into what I'm talking about as far as because if there was a such thing as black supremacy, black power politics wouldn't be a conversation, because most of what we want would be black people would have. We wouldn't have a problem with unemployment. We wouldn't have a problem with not having a voice for those who are considered the underclass in the political arena. But we don't have a lot of people speaking for black people, speaking for Latino people. We don't have, and those who do speak on behalf of the disenfranchised, their microphones are not very large. I mean, the media don't focus a lot on what they're saying, don't bring it to light. And this is the reason why black power politics was necessary, so that the voice of those who don't get heard gets heard. So that those who are being taken advantage of, everybody can see that people are being taken advantage of, and it's wrong and it needs to stop. That's what black power politics was really all about. Now, I want to play H-Rap Brown. He was one of my favorite speakers back in the 1960s, who was a black power politics speaker, in my opinion. And the brother spoke truth to power. You got to hear this, brother. So I want to play him, and we will be back to continue to verbrate on black power politics. Does it exist? What white people really fear? And what they really fear is the fact of having somebody in office that represents the people. And that would include somebody who believes in black power politics. So we will be back in just a second.
What about politics? Where do black people fit into the political spectrum right now? Or should they at all?
Well, politics is defined by the geographical and influential spheres of this country. It's irrelevant to black people, and it's irrelevant to the masses of people. The vote has been used as a tool of oppression against black people. I mean, Camus raises a very good point when he says, what better way to enslave a man than give him the vote and call him free? See, it does not profit black people or poor people anything to have the vote and not be able to select the candidates who they want to choose. Now, how can you choose between Lyndon Johnson, Nixon, Agnew, Wallace, and Humphrey? There is no choice. Evil is evil. There's nothing in between that.
There was some lesser candidates. Dick Gregory running for office. Eldridge Cleaver.
I think the vote can only be used as a tool of organization. We can only use the vote to organize our people. Now, to really believe that we can put someone in office and that these people would be responsive to our needs is naive, politically naive. Because even if one of the black candidates who ran for office was to take the office of president, then black people must be prepared to fight against that person.
Why?
Because, you see, the system mandates the action of the individual. The individual does not determine how this country will function. This country works off the military-industrial complex, which means that it's profitable to wage war. And unless you, you know, devise another plan, another scheme to sustain, to boost this economy, then it's going to be necessary to wage war, whether, you know, a black individual is in office or a white individual is in office. Well, so we're talking about a complete a change in system.
If Mr. Cleaver did win the election, don't you think that he could have conducted the presidency in a unique manner that may not be, you know, compromising to the system you speak of?
No, because, you, as I said, the system dictates the response of individuals. You see, individuals do not influence politically, economically, or socially.
I see.
The attitudes or functioning of the system.
Well, if politics as we know it here in this country is not the answer, what is?
I think there has to be a reevaluation of politics. Now, there are definitions of politics that are relevant to black people. Chairman Mao says that politics is war without bloodshed, and war is an extension of politics. I think black people have to begin to address themselves to the politics of revolution, because we are caught up in revolutionary struggle, whether we want to believe it or whether we want to be or not. So I think, you know, black people have to begin to think in a revolutionary fashion and create and construct a politically revolutionary platform.
Is this going to be a race revolution, or is it going to be a class revolution?
I think, you know, like in terms of struggle and who will comprise the revolutionary front of that struggle, it will be oppressed people. You see, black people are in the vanguard position of the struggle because we've been the most dispossessed. However, there are other oppressed people in this country: Mexican American, the Spanish American community, the Puerto Ricans, American Indian, Japanese Americans, and even poor whites. But racism, I don't believe that racism will allow poor whites to form alliances with the revolutionary groups in this country.
Got stuck there for a little bit, but that was H-Rap Brown. And H-Rap Brown was a political activist, civil rights activist, and speaker. Started out on with Stokely Carmichael. I believe he was a part of SNCC at one time and then broke off from SNCC. But he was a very vocal brother. You know, I mean, anybody who was following the civil rights leaders back in the 1960s would know about H-Rap Brown because he was very vocal once he broke off on his own. A little bit about his bio right here. Okay. His name was Jamal Abdullah Al-Amin. His birth name was Herbert Gerald Brown, October 4th, 1943, also known as H-Rap Brown. He was the fifth chairman of the Student of Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. Like I said, he was a part of SNCC. He was but in the 1960s, during a short-lived six-month alliance between SNCC and the Black Panther Party, he served as their Minister of Justice. He is perhaps most famous for his proclamation during the period that violence is as American as cherry pie, and that if America don't come around, we're going to burn it down. He's also known for his autobiography, Die Nigger Die. He is currently serving a life sentence for murder following a 2000 shooting of two Fulton County sheriff deputies. One deputy, Ricky Kitchen, died in the shooting. So that's H. Brown, who you just heard. And that was a little brief bio on Brother H. Brown. There's more I can read on his activism because the brother was intelligent. I got more audio cast. Got another audio cast I want to play by him. Also, I didn't pull up some audio casts. I thought I was going to pull some audio casts up of Brother Stokely Carmichael, a.k.a. Kwame Ture. I thought maybe if I continue this subject matter next week, then I'll play some audio cast with Brother Stokely Carmichael. I liked him better as Stokely Carmichael because he was really outspoken against the system, whereas when he became Kwame Ture, Brother Stokely became more of a national figure, speaking more of the things that was happening to Africans and black people on a national scale. instead of speaking, being the voice of black people in America, which he was when he was Stokely Carmichael. So that's just my take on the whole situation. But back to the podcast topic, which is black power politics. Does it exist today? That's the question. What do you say, Queen? Does it exist today? Does black power politics exist today?
Well, that's a hard one for me because, like I said, you know, I don't really think it really truly exists and the driving force that's needed behind it. I think if it is being used in practice, it's done too quietly for it to be seen. So that's kind of hard for me to say whether it's being actually used and utilized. But I don't think it's being done in the driving force that's necessary to get stuff done, get a change in this country.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. Well, because when it comes down to black power politics, just based on the philosophical philosophy of black liberation, the question is it happening like that? Are we really liberated? Are we liberated? Does it appear that we're liberated? That's a question I raise based on the fact that if black people is truly liberated, well, would white people stand and would the U.S. government allow black people to be killed, unarmed black people to be killed, and police officers, for the most part, go unacquitted. They're not convicted. They're not charged with anything. They go free. Matter of fact, in a lot of cases, they are still able to keep their jobs. And so, these are the type of things that's just one issue, you know, amongst the many issues that plagued the black community that black power politics spoke to. Okay, I see my sister in the conference room. You got anything you want to add to the table on black power politics? I'm not sure you were following me. I know you left for a minute. I turned off your microphone just for a minute because there was some backdrop noise in the backdrop there. But if you got something you want to bring to the table, sis, please do.
I want to listen a little bit more so I can connect. It's kind of, yeah, my phone had cut off. So I got that going.
Okay. Well, you know, I got another.
Listen for a little bit. Yeah.
Okay, we're talking about black power politics. Does it exist today? We both, I mean, I'm pretty sure anybody can be honest and be truthful about the fact that Barack Obama being the first black president, so-called the first black president, did he exemplify black power politics? Is black power politics necessary? And do people know what black power politics is? Black power politics in the past of the 1960s spoke truth to white supremacy, spoke truth to the powers to be, spoke truth to government powers. Black power politics also, in a brief example I gave earlier, and I will read it again a little bit. Black power politics, in short, are political ideas with agendas that are meant to aid, educate, and protect black people with equal constitutional rights and liberties under the constitutional law. And so that's what black power politics is. I also gave an example of black power politics. I read an accomplishment that Martin Luther King had did back that got done because of Martin Luther King and his organized marches, the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the 1965 Voting Rights Act was passed as a result of the perseverance of Dr. Martin Luther King. Again, that's black power politics at work at its finest. So black power politics is something that you hear and something that you can see, meaning that you will hear a person speak it and you will see it enacted when laws are changed as a result of political pressure put on by people. That's what Martin Luther King put pressure on the government with marches and rallies and speaking out against white supremacy. And saying that, look, if the government is supposed to be for the people, by the people, then the government should be protecting the people against tyranny, against terrorism, which is white supremacy. And that's what Martin Luther King represented. And so I give that brother the trophy of black power politics trophy. Yeah, and that's what I would give Brother Martin Luther King, because he endured. He endured a lot. You feel me? Even up until his death. That's what he was. You know, he became a martyr when he was assassinated because of what he represented. Another person to me who spoke and exemplify black power politics will be Brother Frederick Douglass. And I was speaking about that earlier. I was also in the podcast, I was speaking about his 1894 speech that he wrote titled The Colony of Fallen, the Folly of Colonization, where Frederick Douglass speak about how back in the late 19th century, they were talking about relocating black people from the U.S. to Africa against our will. And Frederick Douglass was the only one that spoke against it. He was the only one that spoke out against it. And he wrote a speech called The Folly of Colonization. January 9th, 1894 is when he wrote this speech. I'm not sure if you're familiar with that, sis, if you're familiar with that speech. But you can access that speech online. I got some of it right here. I can read some of it, but it ain't no joke. The speech ain't no joke. But he spoke truth to power, you know.
Frederick Douglass?
Yes, Frederick Douglass. Frederick Douglass knew who we were. In this speech right here that I got right here called The Speech by Frederick Douglass, The Folly of Colonization, 1894. Let me read. I'll read the first paragraph. I've read it before, but I'll read it again. Check it out. It goes like this. It said, it is the proposition to colonize the colored people of America in Africa or somewhere else. Happily, this scheme will be defeated, both by its implicity and its impracticality. It is all nonsense to talk about the removal of 8 million of American people from their home in America to Africa. This expense and hardship, to say nothing of the cruelty attending to such a measure, would make success impossible. The American people are wicked, but they are not fools. They will hardly be disposed to incur the expense, to say nothing of the injustice which this measure demands. Nevertheless, this colonization scheme, unworthy as it is of American statesmanship and American honor, and through full of mischief to the colored people, seems to have a strong hold on the public mind, and at times has shown much life and vigor. Part 2, paragraph 2. The bad thing about it is that it has a late, owing to persecution, to begun to advocate by colored men of acknowledged ability and learning. And every little while, some white statesman becomes its advocate. Those gentlemen will doubtlessly have their opinion of me. I certainly have my opinion of them. My opinion is that if they are sensible, they are insincere. And if they are insincere, they are not sensible. They know, or they ought to know, that it would take more money than the cost of the late war to transport even one half of the colored people of the United States to Africa. Whether intentionally or not, they are, as I think, simply trifling with an afflicted people. They urge them to look for relief where they ought to know that relief is impossible. The only excuse they can make for the measure is that there is no hope for the Negro here, and that the colored people in America owe something to Africa. Now, that's only, I haven't even read all of it. I only just read just two paragraphs. But this speech ain't no joke. The speech is no joke. And the more you read it, the more you can feel and hear the hurt, the pain, the anguish, and the anger that Frederick Douglass felt about this scheme that they had planned on forcing black people to go to Africa. And you'll know, if you read the entire speech, you'll notice that Frederick Douglass never refers to people, black people in America, as Africans. He refers to the Africans in Africa as Africans. But he says that black people in America are native to America. So he knew that black people were the children of the indigenous people of North America. Frederick Douglass knew this. So I would encourage anybody who have not read the entire work or speech of Frederick Douglass to please go online. Just Google the folly of colonization. Frederick Douglass's speech, January 9th, 1894. So that's on that. But I got another audio cast I want to play by H. Brown. And you get a chance again, truth, because Black Power Politics is all about truth. Truth speaking to power. Truth correcting political power with political truth. And so I'm going to play this and we shall return.
Do you feel that Black people will ever have a strong political voice in this country in the formal sense as we understand it? You mentioned that you don't think that this could ever come about. Is there any chance that it might?
No, I think that's a reformist, you know, like, position to assume for me to say that Black people will one day occupy in this system political offices of importance. Now, you know, this brings on a whole discussion of control, you see, and how you control, because anything that you don't control is used as a weapon against you. Now, in terms of Black people occupying positions, America has created in Cleveland, Washington, D.C., and Gary, Indiana, a type of neo-colonialism. In other words, the man has set up a puppet regime. These Black people are responsive to the needs and the whims of the Democratic Party and not of the masses of Black people. If Johnson is president, or whoever is president, were to tell Stokes or Hatcher or Walter Washington to send Black people to concentration camps, then there would be no discussion, because they would see it as their job, because they hold a position that's, you know, responsive or that's sensitive to the Democratic Party.
Do you view those that are in prominent positions that are Black sort of a token gesture on the part of the establishment, like a member of the Supreme Court bench, there was a Black member of the cabinet, so forth?
I think that has to be examined in the sense of progress and as to whether Black people have made progress in this country. Mm-hmm. My contention is that Black people have not made progress in this country. America has given Blacks some concessions out of political necessity, their political necessity. They gave Thurgood Marshall a position on the Supreme Court to appease Black people. In other words, we didn't put Thurgood Marshall there. They can take Thurgood Marshall whenever they get ready. We put Adam in office. They took Adam out. They gave Black people an astronaut, and they killed him. So what happens is that has to be viewed in the light of concessions. The very fact that the man can concede a position to you tells you that you do not have a position of power where you can demand, or that you can mandate something.
There you go. You heard it again. H. Brown speaking the raw and uncut. Black Power Politics speaking truth to power. Now, he basically was saying, just like he was saying in the first clip that I played of H. Brown, basically when a man asked him about Black people participating in politics and about having a representative, and he said, you know, when you got the system that's basically controlling the people in office, because the system has an agenda, he's saying you have to change the system. And and when you listen to him right there, the same thing, he's saying the same thing. You know, how can we have representatives when these representatives are dedicated to the job rather than to the people? Because the system tells them how to operate and what to do. And that's what I said. Black Power Politics spoke truth. Black Power Politics was like a light that shows up the evil that's hiding in the darkness. That's what Black Power Politics did. Now, what the white man has done over the years, by ignoring these voices, like the only voice they want to hear, and it constantly, and they do this every year, is the voice of Martin Luther King. If you know it, they play the same recording every year. I had a dream. They play the same shit every year. I had a dream. You know, but they don't tell you. They don't say this every year, that within the years before Martin Luther King's death, he had a change of heart and a change of mind on the focus of his mission and agenda. He realized that he had went from one phase, and now he was in the phase of Black Power revolutionaries. Like, he had joined forces. He was actually collaborating with Stokely Carmichael. And I believe this is what led up to his assassination. Now, I got some audio cast that speaks about him, that Martin Luther King. and his alliance with Stokely Carmichael. Remember, Stokely Carmichael was also, like H. Brown, he was an activist, a speaker, a lecturer, for the purpose of civil rights. Also, what Stokely Carmichael was doing also in the late 60s, early 70s, late 60s, he was putting together, trying to create a political party, a black political party. And at the time, the name remained SNCC, which was S-N-C-C, which is Student Coordinating, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. He was trying to create another party because he felt like the Democratic Party and the Republican Party didn't represent the black community, let alone representing the poor community. Because when you talk about the poor community, that includes poor blacks, poor whites, poor Latinos. So he looked at the political spectrum and said, "What? Nobody, not the part. If the parties don't represent the people, how can they have a voice in government?" That's why there's nobody to represent black people or Latino people or poor people in government. And so Stokely Carmichael was putting together a political party, and he was trying to get Martin Luther King to be a part of it. You feel me? And I think that scared white folks. I think white folks was afraid of that. That's why I say, what white people are really afraid of? White people are really afraid of black power politics, because black power politics shows up white supremacy. White supremacy cannot hide amongst politicians like it do if black power politics was still around. Black power politics is not around. It's still around, but it's not around in the political. It's not basically checking and balancing the political arena like it was in the 1960s. And the reason why is because the media is still the same in the essence that it gives the microphone to who they want and ignores who they don't want, who the politicians don't want to hear. So the media still plays the game that they've been playing since the 1950s and the 60s. What has changed is a national voice, a voice that's willing to weather the storm. And that's what you don't hear no more. After the killing of people like Medgar Evers, Martin Luther King, Malcolm X, and then the destruction of the Black Panther Party, black people seem like they just didn't have it in them to speak up no more. What do you think, Queen? Am I wrong on this?
No, I don't think you're wrong at all. With media doing the ignore you and pretend you're not here, along with the rest of white America, it's really showing if there is anybody speaking out, if there is anyone pushing for the black power politics and advocating for black people,
black
not being actually vocalized on any media platform. Really.
Exactly, because black power politics would, I mean, now when I say there's no national voice, well, they want to give that trophy to Black Lives Matter. Okay, and in a sense, Black Lives Matter has been the only voice
that they're willing to
pay any attention to, which was put together by three or four women, and their sexuality has been brought up as far as them being gay. To me, that doesn't matter, and this is why I see a lot of black folks need to wake the hell up, stop tripping off of people, stay out of people's bedroom, stay off of people's private parts. Mm-mm. If she want to be with she and he want to be with he, that's their business. We trying to get some jobs up off in there. We trying to get some opportunity. They want to say that black people's opportunity is solely based on the lack of education. Well, that's not true. Just go back to the 1950s and the 60s. White folks didn't have no education, and yet they had all the jobs. Okay, now we know we're in a time where now we have more technology and things are more technical. But yet, look at the fact that you have black folks from slavery from slavery of 1864 through the times of the industrialized period and period in this country to all the way to the 1950s. You had black folks who were uneducated. You had a system that did not assist black people in the means of educating them after being enslaved for over 300 to 400 to 500 years in a country enslaved on plantations, building the wealth for the white elite. So yet they free these people, and you got a whole nation of people, of colored people, who are uneducated, don't understand how the system works. And the only thing they know is how to pick cotton, grow corn, cultivate tobacco, and that was it. And then you had a small group of black people who were those who assimilated to the system, who became the house pets for the elite, became the mouthpiece for the elite. So, you know, bottom line is that, in my opinion, black power politics is still necessary and needed. Whenever you got cops that can kill black people, is what?
Do you think it's the fear? Do you think it's the fear that's causing people to really?
Of course,
they their opinions
I agree.
They can go only so far, but
look, the thing about black power politics speaks to people who say you only can go so far, because if Martin Luther King thought like that, he would have never took things to the level he took them. He took things to the end, knowing that the end means might be his life. He was willing to lay his life down for his brother. That's why he became venerated, immortalized, because his reputation of being nonviolent did not go away from the fact that he was willing to still speak truth to power. And that's what black power politics is all about. Barack Obama did not exemplify black power politics because his motto was a conformist position. What was that conforming to? Bringing everybody to the table and let's benefit everybody. But did not everybody didn't get benefited, because the people who he was serving first at the table were the elite, were corporations. When he
so those are the ones that would tell him what he can do and what he can't do. So if he did want to, he didn't want to sacrifice his life creating under fear. Is the reason why he he couldn't do what he really wanted to do.
Well, for one thing, he did. For one thing, in my conscious opinion, he could not relate to the everyday black person. Now, that does not mean that he did not experience prejudice or some sense of form of, bigotry from a white person. It means that his reaction to that bigotry, his reaction or his conception or comprehension of how to react to that bigotry wouldn't be what me or you, how me and you would react to it. You know, because we come from a generation and generations of black people who've been oppressed through bigotry and white supremacy. Well, you gotta look at it. Barack Obama don't come from that. He come from a white mama. That white woman didn't experience no black oppression. She was a white woman. And he was raised by his white grandparents. He was not raised by his father, who was a Kenyan from Africa. And his father, who was a Kenyan, was still a political official in Kenya. His father had political affiliations, but yet he didn't have a relationship with his father. He met his father twice. He was not raised by his father. He was raised by a white woman, his mother, and his white grandparents, her parents. So,
don't you believe if he did take a step out for our people to make a change, ancestors, and do you not think that he will be assassinated like the rest of them that did?
Maybe, maybe not. I mean, that's not something that you question when you put yourself in a position of leadership. And he put himself in a position of leadership, and he used the black community to help push him into the position that he got. Regardless of people want to say black people's vote mattered or not, or it wasn't the black vote to put him in there. No, it was the black vote, and it was the vote of young people on college campuses who was his grassroots organizers who worked for him, who helped put him there. Now some people might say, well, you know what, he still won the electoral. Go ahead.
Yeah, but do you think that we all have is it a mask, or is it something that's put up front to make us feel that we have some equal faithful that who's in office? Or do you think that the elite that's controlling the world, that created the system, is in a way trying to give us and make us seem like we're getting that we do have a say so, but really we don't? You know what I'm saying?
Well, this is what this is where that clip from H. Brown. He says that the system needs to be revitalized. The system needs to be fixed because the system is set up to fail black people. The system is not set up to. So look, I see what you're saying. So what I'm saying is that this is why.
Yeah, because the system is set up to be the way it is. So the thing is that to even to correct the system, you will have to get rid of the elite.
I'm not arguing that or debating that at all. My argument is this: before anybody take it to any level of, and this is where Martin Luther King believed that everybody can come to the table and talk and bargain and work for the betterment of everyone. That's what Martin Luther King believed. Martin Luther King understood that the elite were behind everything that's going on a national and an international scale, especially what happens here in the U.S. Martin Luther King understood that totally. But his whole game was this. This is the reason why. Matter of fact, let me play this little clip by excerpt by Martin Luther King, and you will see what I'm talking about. We continue it from here.
Dr. King, the other day in Tallahassee, Stokely Carmichael indicated that you and he had reached a rapprochement. Is this true?
Well, I'm not sure what he was referring to.
Are you in agreement as far as the civil rights struggle is concerned on how to fight it?
Oh, we agree on some things we don't agree on. I'm sure we're in agreement on the war in Vietnam. We certainly want to see that war come to an end. And we are in agreement on the fact that Negroes are not free in the United States of America, and we must have a vibrant, dynamic movement alive at all times to make that freedom a reality. But there are other things that Mr. Carmichael would advocate that I would not advocate.
Do you agree with his methods?
Well, you would have to give the particular methods that you're referring to. If you're referring to Black Power, the slogan Black Power, I think there are some positives in that slogan. The psychological call to manhood, the need to amass political and education, economic power to achieve our legitimate goals. This we've all been working for across the years. Now, if at any point Mr. Carmichael would advocate violence, I'm absolutely opposed to that. My position is very clear on it. I think nothing could be more tragic than for the Negro to turn to violence at this time, because we could not win a violent struggle. We have neither the instruments nor the techniques to win a violent struggle. And if we are trying to establish a brotherly society, then we must use methods to establish that society which will make brotherhood a reality. So I couldn't advocate violence.
Dr. King, you've heard his speeches. Do you feel that Stokely Carmichael advocates violence?
Well, in my presence, he's never advocated violence. He's merely said that the question of violence and nonviolence is irrelevant. So I can't say that he's ever advocated violence in my presence, and I've talked with him privately on many occasions. Now, the press has carried statements that he purportedly made that advocated violence. So there is a conflict between what he said to me privately and what has been reported in the press.
Do you see any connection, Dr. King, between the civil disturbances which occurred after Mr. Carmichael has spoken, such as in Nashville, and his speech, his presence on a particular scene or location?
I don't know about that situation enough to really draw any basic conclusion other than conditions existed in Nashville which went far beyond Stokely Carmichael, and it's very easy to pick out a person and blame every riot that develops on that particular person. Riots develop because of conditions that exist in our society. Conditions of poverty in the ghetto, conditions of police brutality in certain situations, conditions of disenchantment on the part of young people and others, and despair, so that I don't think we can point to any individual and say that's a cause of a riot. We will have to look at the real and basic cause, and I think these conditions of economic deprivation and social isolation and psychological frustration are much more at the root of our riots than any particular individual who may make an inciting speech at a time.
Yes. There you go. That was Martin Luther King talking about Stokely Carmichael, and he's talking about his perception on riots. I mean, if you notice, they were trying, if you listen to the press, they was trying, like they were trying to get him to say something negative about Stokely, and he wouldn't say nothing negative about him, huh, Queen? He wouldn't say nothing negative about Stokely. He backed the brother. He said, look, when I spoke to him in privately, he didn't talk no violence. And also, if you listen to what Martin Luther King
said in his presence.
Well, exactly, exactly.
In his presence.
Well, also, if you listen to what Martin Luther King also said about the fact about when it came to violence and the riots. I mean, I like the way he put that together. He said, look, the riots are not, you can pinpoint anything on any one person, but riots are created by the atmosphere of poverty and the lack of economics and stability in the black community. And he's talking about how that creates riots, because basically the voice of the poor is not being heard. And you know, Martin Luther King was just very articulate. I love the way he articulated himself, but that was just an example of again, you know, I think he mentioned something about the revolutionary. I got something else. I got another track that I want to play, one more track I want to play of Martin Luther King. Martin Luther King dropping the raw and uncut, you know. I'm going to play this one right here, and we shall return our podcast topic, which is Black Power Politics. Does it exist?
Yes, sir. It's hard to give a date on that. I think as we continue to move on in the days ahead in the struggle for racial justice, prejudices in the white community will continue to diminish. And I feel that there is a possibility that these prejudices will so diminish that a Negro can be president of the United States in this generation. I do not want to give the impression that I feel a Negro is not capable of being president. There are many Negroes who are capable this day and were capable yesterday and day before yesterday and many days in the past. But because of prejudices and narrow-mindedness, Negroes have been held out of the political arena and certainly held out of the presidency. But I do think that the day will come in the not-too-distant future when the Negro vote itself will be powerful enough to be in a coalition with liberals in the white community and thereby elect a Negro president of the United States. Through neo-colonialism, rather than on the side of the peoples of the third world who are seeking justice and who are seeking freedom and human dignity. The fact that we are engaged in a war in Vietnam, which is basically a civil war, means that we have put ourselves in the position of being a kind of arch anti-revolutionary. And this is tragic because much of the revolutionary spirit of the modern world was initiated by America. And now we find ourselves being in a position of being against these revolutions that are taking place. President Kennedy said on one occasion that those who make peaceful revolutions impossible make violent revolutions inevitable. And so often we have failed to make peaceful revolutions possible.
Woo, again, that is, in my opinion, what I consider Black Power Politics, because it was truth speaking to power. He was speaking about what was going on about the Vietnam War, how it had nothing to do with it. He said it was a civil war. That's between them. It had nothing to do with Americans. He said, "What? In other words, why are we in it?" He said, "We should not even be in that war." And he talked about how it, you know, it creates revolutionaries. It puts people in a position of being revolutionaries when you don't create a resolution, but you cause a revolution by backing up a war that has nothing to do with you. And that's what he was dropping the raw uncut. He was dropping the raw uncut. And that's what I'm talking about. Black power politics. Martin Luther King was a threat because he was a man of truth. Martin Luther King was a threat. Now, what they don't tell people also in history is that in the last 2 years before he had died, Martin Luther King did not have support from the church no more. He didn't have support from a lot of his black politicians. a lot of his friends and a lot of his friends and acquaintances and family abandoned him. They had abandoned him. And the reason why is because he was talking with a lot of black revolutionaries like Stokely Carmichael, like H. Rat Brown. He was talking to those brothers, the Black Panther Party, UEP Newton. Martin Luther King had contact with them brothers, man. And white folks didn't like that. House niggas didn't like that. Them little lapdog Negroes, yes, massa. Yes, he's messing with our money. They didn't like that. So, run uncut just like that here on the Black Village Community Podcast. My show is actually over. I didn't took it over, extended it as I always do. But before we go, anybody got any last words? Sis, you got any last words you want to give? Anything you might want to say about? I'm not sure if you was, you know, I didn't get a chance to read. I wanted to read the Black Panthers 10-point program. Another thing, the reason why I want to read that is because it speaks again, black power politics again. Black power politics. White folks are scared of that. They're scared of that. And the Black Panthers had a 10-point program, and that program was basically demands. They were asking for the government that they say that the government owed us. At least they owed this to us because they cheated us out of 40 acres and a mule when black folks was freed from slavery. So you know what? This 10-point thing that we asking for ain't that much, government. That's what the Black Panther Party was saying. And the Black Panther was, they were determined to get a lot of these things done that's on this list. Matter of fact, so let me, before you guys give your last words, let me read this. It's called the Black Panthers 10-point program. Point one, we want freedom. We want power to determine the destiny of our black and oppressed communities. We believe that black and oppressed people will not be free until we are able to determine our destinies and our communities ourselves by fully controlling all the institutions which exist in our communities. That's one. Two, we want full employment for our people. We believe that the federal government is responsible and obligated to give every person employment or a guaranteed income. We believe that if the American business will not give full employment, then the technology and means of production should be taken from the businessmen and placed in the community so that the people of the community can organize and employ all of its people and give a high standard of living. Three, we want an end to the robbery by the catalyst of our black and oppressed communities. We believe that this racist government has robbed us, and now we are demanding the overdue debt of 40 acres and two mules. 40 acres and two mules were promised 100 years ago as a restitution for the slave labor and mass murder of black people. We will accept the payment in currency, which will be distributed to our communities. The American racist has taken part in the slaughter of our 50 million black people. Therefore, we feel this is a modest demand that we make. Four, we want decent housing fit for the shelter of human beings. We believe that if the landlords will not give decent housing to our black and oppressed communities, then housing and the land should be made into cooperative so that the people in our communities, which with government aid, can build and make decent housing for the people. Five, we want decent education for our people that expose the true nature of the decadent American society. We want education that teaches us our true history and our role in the present day society. We believe in an educational system that will give to our people a knowledge of self. If you do not have knowledge of yourself, your position in the society, in the world, then you will have little chance to know anything else. Six, we want completely free health care for all black and oppressed people. We believe that the government must provide free of charge for the people health facilities which will not only treat our illnesses, most of which have come about as a result of our oppression, but which will also develop preventive medical programs to guarantee our future survival. We believe that the mass health education and research programs must be developed to give all Black and oppressed people access to advanced scientific and medical information so we may provide ourselves with proper medical attention and care. Okay, let me scroll down. 7, we want an immediate end to police brutality and murder of Black people, other people of color, and all oppressed people inside the United States. We believe that the racist and fascist government of the United States uses its domestic enforcement agencies to carry out its program of oppression against Black people, other people of color, and poor people inside the United States. We believe it is our right, therefore, to defend ourselves against such an armed force, and that all Black people oppressed and should be armed for self-defense of our homes and communities against fascist police forces. I love it. White people didn't like it. They like, they were scared when they saw this. They got terrified. I can imagine when they read this. I can imagine when congressmen and politicians, they were, them white fools, they were terrified. 8. We want an immediate end to all wars of aggression. We believe that the various conflicts which exist around the world stem directly from the aggressive desires of the United States ruling circle and government to force its domination upon the oppressed people of the world. We believe that the United States government or its lackeys do not cease these aggressive wars. It is the right of the people to defend themselves by any means necessary against their aggressors. 9. We want freedom for all Black people, all Black and oppressed people now held in U.S. federal, state, county, and military prisons and jails. We want trials by a jury of peers for all persons charged with so-called crimes under the laws of this country. We believe that the many Black and poor oppressed people now held in the United States prisons and jails have not received fair and impartial trials under a racist and fascist judicial system and should be free from incarceration. We believe in the ultimate elimination of all wretched, inhumane penal institutions because the mass of men and women in prison in the United States by the United States military and are the victims of oppressed conditions, which are the real cause of their imprisonment. We believe that when the persons are brought to trial, they must be guaranteed by the United States jury of their peers, attorneys of their choice, and freedom from imprisonment while awaiting trial. And last but not least, 10. We want land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, peace, and people's community control of modern technology. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bonds which have connected them with another and assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal stations to which the laws of nature and nature of God's entitled entitled them a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the cause which impel them to separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure the rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the government. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute a new government, lay its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to effect as their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that government long established should not be changed for light and transistent causes. And accordingly, all experiences have shown that mankind are most disposed of to suffer while evils are sufferable than the rights themselves. Man, all I know is this 10-point thing ain't no joke. And I didn't even finish reading the entire paragraph, but you know, I gotta go. It was a beautiful thing. Did you hear it, Queen? What did you think about what you just heard when I read the 10-point manifesto of the Black Panther Party?
It sounds like something that should be already done and in charge. I mean, why it should be we still having to fight for the same thing that we've been fighting for just since colonization.
Exactly. I mean, he said the last of the 10 point, that the 10th point, we want land, bread, housing, education, clothing, justice, peace, and people's community control of modern technology. I'm like, whoa, these brothers, they were speaking to the future of things. You hear that, Queen? And so that's a beautiful thing. We will be back. We will be black. You know, I've enjoyed myself. Queen, you got any last words before we head out of here?
Well, I'm enjoyed this session today. I learned quite a bit today, and I hope those listening can help use this information and teach it and exercise it and find out what we all can do and share that information with each other.
I totally agree. Also, I want to say that, you know, my sister was talking about, you know, she's not on, she left the conference room, but about fear being an issue amongst black. It's a huge issue, I think, in the black community. The sad thing about it, if you don't have the fear to hurt, steal, cheat, take from your brother, if you don't have the fear to kill your brother, then you shouldn't have fear to stand up for what's right. Matter of fact, sound like to me there need to be a change in the community. Young black men and young black women need to realize that the thing that we should fear is hurting one another. The things that we should fear should be cheating and stealing from one another. That's what we should fear. We should fear hurting our mothers and our brothers and our fathers. Our fathers should fear hurting their sons. We should fear doing the wrong things. That's what we should fear, so that we don't do the wrong things. And we should be men to stand up for what's right. And that's what black power politics was all about. Speaking truth to a lie. Speaking truth to white supremacy. Speaking truth and equality. Not just for black people, but they realized that anything that affected black people affect everybody. There's not been anything that only affected black people politically. Anything that affected black people politically affected the rest of the minority community. That includes the Latino and Asian community as well, and women as well. So on that note, you know, I gotta go. We gotta grow. You feel me? And, you know, I will be back. And the intro to the show, I didn't get a chance to mention that. That was T.I. off his song called 40 Acres. And so I'm going to leave with that. I'm going to leave with 40 Acres playing, and that's going to be my outro to the show. You must listen to the message in that. T.I. must give it up to him. You know, his last couple albums that he's put out, he's been putting out a lot of politically conscious messages of truth. And also, you get a chance to see his heart, that he understands what's going on politically around us, as him being a man and a father himself. So I got much respect and much love for Brother T.I. But the intro that you heard earlier, that rap song, was from his song called 40 Acres. T.I., him and Killer Mike, and another brother was on there. And I'm going to conclude, I'm going to end the show on that note with the same song, 40 Acres by T.I. I will be back, and I will be black. And hopefully my queen will be here, and we'll be dropping nothing but the raw and uncut. You can always join us here on the Black Village Community Podcast. It doesn't cost you a dime, just a bit of your conscious time. You can always chime in at 857-232-0155. You can also chime in at 855-445-9340. And don't forget the conference key to get through the conference door and sit here in the conference room of truth with us here at the Black Village Community Podcast, which is 947595. And also, please chime in and check out Mystic Roots. Check out our store where we sell African products, natural cosmetics, art, and all that, you know, Mystic Roots. .com. So that's MYSTIK Roots, ROOTZ. So please check that out. And that we you can find us at Your African Market, yourafricanmarket.mysticroots.com. Again, that's yourafricanmarket.mysticroots.com. And check us out there, please. But we will be back, and we will be black next Delicious Black Sunday, dropping nothing but the raw and uncut here on the Black Village, the Black Village Community Podcast, with yours truly, Jaycee, a.k.a. AfroBlack, your storm of consciousness. I will be back. See ya. Gotta go. And as always, I love chicken, love peace and chicken grease. Anybody interrupt freedom, kill him. Word to a Robert F. Williams, feel him. Devil got me sick with my stomach. Woo. Word to Elijah Muhammad. Ooh. I don't give a damn what the preacher ever tell y'all. Jesus Muhammad ain't coming. Woo. I'ma tell y'all what the ancestors should've did when they seen the first boat coming. Yeah. Killed every man, child, woman. Yeah. Killed every damn thing on it. Yeah. Killed everything. If it looked European, send it back to the queen like, oh. You ever step your foot in Kimmy, bitch, we slit your throat. We sent them funny fuckboy preacher type back to the boat. Fuck is you? Fuck your Zeus, fuck Medusa. This the school of Chaka Zula. Fast forward to the future. Chopper do you when they dying and they crying. Screaming hallelujah when them crackers ask why. Say we did it, follow me, motherfucker. 40 acres and a mula. I spent my reparations on the jeweler. I bought a timepiece, now ain't no looking back. Now ask them motherfuckers what the fuck they looking at. 40 acres and a mule. 40 acres and a mule. These niggas acting fool. With Benjamin. Who the fuck are you? I've been to me. The cracker see me on that him again. Say ass at the jet, middle finger to Trump. Fuck the police, they crooked as they come. They pull you over and know you legit. Ask you for your license when you reaching they dumb. Now the prison yard like the confier. House nigga snitching, that what got him killed. Nigga thought he made it cause he got a deal. First album pulled to been out of here. Not quite though, back to selling blues. 24s on the center here. Learn stay silent. Learn more for these streets. They did Nate College. I'm certified. Don't murder guy, but my nigga still off civil life. Kill for anything but civil right. Be the murder case, cause a nigga like. Dirty front of king, front of king, what you mean? Bitch. Trip my 40 acres for my mule and my neck. Yeah. 40 acres and a mule. I spent my reparations on the jeweler. I bought a timepiece, now ain't no looking back. Now ask them motherfuckers what the fuck they looking at.
Rock.